This is the FEMA Substantial Damage Estimator Training Series. Welcome to Module 1, the purpose of the SDE tool. After a disaster or other source causes damage to a structure, communities that participate in the National Flood Insurance Program, or NFIP, must carry out an evaluation of the property that has been impacted by the event in order to determine whether the property has been substantially damaged. This module is the first of 10 that will cover a range of topics related to substantial damage estimation. These modules are designed to be a cohesive training that will guide you from the basics of substantial damage estimation using FEMA's SDE tool to the performance of an assessment in the field on a structure. Each module can also be viewed as a standalone training so that you can refer back to specific modules as needed when questions arise. After completing this training, you will understand the purpose of conducting substantial damage estimations, understand what the FEMA SDE tool is and how to use it, and know how to properly assess a structure that has been damaged. Throughout this course, we will review the different parts of the SDE evaluation process and demonstrate how the FEMA SDE tool can be used to conduct substantial damage assessments. In Module 1, we'll cover a basic introduction to this training, some of the National Flood Insurance Program requirements related to substantial damage, and some general guidance for making substantial damage determinations. This training was designed to help assist local and state officials in making substantial damage determinations in accordance with the NFIP using the FEMA Substantial Damage Estimator software. Before beginning the training, it is important to consider several questions related to performing substantial damage estimations. Has your community ever performed SDE assessments before? If so, how have you been performing these assessments? Have you been using FEMA's SDE tool? What are the benefits and challenges of using this tool? What is the basis for substantial damage determinations, and how is the SDE data that is collected used to make determinations of substantial damage? What is the process in your community for reevaluating a substantial damage determination if there is an appeal by a property owner? The SDE tool was developed in response to the challenges that many local and state officials face as they try to conduct substantial damage assessments in accordance with the NFIP after major disasters. The primary purpose of developing the tool is to give those officials with limited appraisal or construction backgrounds a way of developing reasonable estimates of the value of buildings and the damage to those buildings. The tool should also be a resource for a seasoned damage inspector by providing an organized platform to prepare data and calculate damages in a consistent format that can be used as supporting documentation to ensure the community remains in compliance with NFIP regulations. The FEMA SDE tool is free software that can be downloaded from FEMA's website, along with the user manual and field guidebook. This presentation will give a thorough overview of using the tool and performing assessments, but the SDE manual provides in-depth detail that may be useful as a reference once your community has begun carrying out assessments. Throughout this training, you will notice references to specific sections of the user's manual and field book, which provide more detailed information on the topic that is currently being covered. The SDE software also has a help menu and numerous links within the tool that can provide assistance in answering questions you may have about the tool and performing assessments. There are also PowerPoint slides, answers to frequently asked questions, and best practices for SDE, which can be found on FEMA's website and can be reviewed and used as reference documents as well. One of the best things about the SDE tool is that it acts as an organizing platform for all the substantial damage data that a community needs to collect on structures after a major event. Since it is designed specifically for collecting substantial damage information, the data is organized into an easily reviewable format that is conducive to making determinations of whether a structure has been substantially damaged. Some of the objectives for using the tool include identifying data that needs to be collected to make a substantial damage determination, recording that data in a formal and organized manner, and housing a database of inventoried structures that need to be evaluated. Other objectives include providing a repository to store photos and other files that support making SDE determinations, Creating reports that summarize the data collected and the calculations that led to the substantial damage determination, and meeting NFIP requirements related to performing substantial damage determinations. Another feature of the SDE tool is that it allows the user to perform assessments on both residential and non-residential structures. Much of the information that needs to be collected to perform an assessment, such as structure attributes, must be entered whether you are performing a residential or non-residential assessment. As we will see, there are some differences between performing a residential and non-residential assessment. We will cover both residential and non-residential assessments in more detail in a later module, but there are some key elements that you should know about each type of assessment before we proceed. Evaluations of residential structures in SDE are based on performing an assessment of 12 different building elements, including the structure's foundation, superstructure, and roofing. Each of these elements is assessed separately, and a percent damage determination is made for each. There is also a built-in square footage calculator that facilitates determining the square footage of a structure if that information is not already known. Another useful feature is the attachment tool, which allows users to upload attachments such as photos of the structure, elevation certificates, and other useful documentation. Finally, the tool allows the user to import or export data from non-SDE databases so that users who have structure data from an existing database can easily import that data into the tool to perform an assessment, and also export the resulting assessment to a format that is compatible with local programs or systems. In cases where the user would like to collect additional information that is not built directly into the tool, there is an option to add up to 3 additional data fields so that this information can be collected in the field as well. As mentioned, there are a number of different attributes of a structure that can be collected as residential structures are being assessed, and each of these attributes contains different options within the tool that can be selected to identify the specific structural attributes. The SDE tool also has the capability to perform assessments on non-residential features, which tend to vary widely based on structure use. Although the tool does not identify every non-residential structure use that may exist, it does include many options to choose from. These options were vetted through a range of industry experts to try to consolidate the most common structure uses in communities across the country. Non-residential structure attributes that can be identified using the tool include structure use and whether the structure has a sprinkler system and/or conveyance system. The user can also select the quality of the construction and make cost adjustments to the structure's value by altering different options within the tool. Like residential structures, non-residential structures are also evaluated in terms of the damage sustained to each element of the structure. This damage is calculated based on a percentage value determined by the assessor. For non-residential structures, there are only 7 elements to evaluate versus the 12 that must be evaluated for residential structures. One of the other key elements for calculating substantial damage is to determine the building value of the structure. To remain in compliance with NFIP requirements, there are 3 options for determining the building value when performing substantial damage estimates. The first is that the SDE tool will calculate the computed actual cash value, or ACV, based on the data that you provide as part of the assessment. The other 2 values can be obtained from other sources, often the local tax office or appraiser. No matter which option is selected, this number becomes the denominator in the overall equation to determine substantial damage. The numerator in the substantial damage equation is the cost of repairs. There are 3 ways to determine the cost of repairs that meet NFIP requirements. The first is to let the SDE tool compute the damages, again, based on information that the assessor puts into the tool. The other 2 options can be obtained through a contractor or the community's estimate. Once the cost of repairs and the value of the building are calculated, the repair cost is divided by the building value to get an overall percent damage calculation. If the result of that calculation is 50% or greater, the structure is considered substantially damaged. As explained previously, one of the primary objectives of the SDE tool is to try to help local officials carry out the important process of determining substantial damage at a time when they are often very busy and may not have time to thoroughly make these determinations with existing tools and information. The tool creates a streamlined approach that allows users to evaluate structures across the community in a quick and consistent manner, thereby allowing them to stay in compliance with the requirements set forth in the National Flood Insurance Program. As damage assessments begin in the post-disaster period, it is important to try to keep in mind some simple guidelines for performing substantial damage estimates. There are a few key types of damage to focus on when carrying out any assessment. These include looking for physical damage on both the surface and subsurface of each element, evaluating damage to structural elements that are permanent features of the structure, not portable items like furniture or televisions, determining if there is a loss of use of elements such as HVAC units, and identifying mechanical damage that may affect the normal functions of a structural element. While those rules are applicable for any assessment you may be performing on any hazard, certain other considerations should be made when performing an assessment in coastal or high-velocity flood areas. For example, saltwater frequently causes more damage to a structure than a similar duration of freshwater flooding, so this should be taken into consideration when evaluating coastal structures. In addition, structures in high-velocity riverine zones or coastal areas may experience a stronger surge from waves that can push structures off their foundations and cause severe damage that should be included as part of the damage assessment. Another important rule of thumb when performing inspections is that entering a home or other private property should be done with caution, and only if the property owner has given you explicit permission to do so. Most inspections should begin by knocking on the door of the house or alerting the owner to your presence in some fashion. Explain who you are and the organization you are representing, and then ask permission to perform a damage assessment of the property. In most cases, property owners will be happy to oblige, but if they refuse the inspection, it may be necessary to leave the premises. In these cases, do not put yourself in danger and simply report the refusal back to your team lead or supervisor. If there is no one present, do not enter the structure. Many assessments can still be completed from the outside of the structure, so you should proceed to complete the assessment without entering and by gathering as much information as possible from your observations. With the SDE tool, inspections should be carried out relatively quickly. After performing several assessments with the tool, a typical inspection should require roughly 15 minutes to complete. Remember to stay focused on collecting the information that the tool requests, and that you are only providing percent damage estimates, not trying to calculate the dollar value of damages on your own. The SDE tool was developed so that this calculation could be completed within the tool itself. In this vein, note that all inspections are intended to be visual only. There is generally no need for tools such as levels or ladders to perform up-close evaluations of building elements. Inspectors should also keep their personal safety in mind. If there is any question about the structural integrity of the building, you should not enter and should perform the assessment to the best of your ability at a safe distance. For non-residential inspections, many of the same rules of thumb apply. Inspectors should not enter any building without the owner's permission and should keep safety in mind in all situations. Often due to their size and custom design, non-residential inspections can also take longer to perform than residential inspections. When carrying out a non-residential inspection, account for the extra time it may take to complete the inspection as you are planning your day, and make sure to take extra caution if you are in a structure that contains large equipment or machinery that may be dangerous. If at any time you feel you are in an unsafe situation, you should leave and report the situation to your team lead. One important distinction in terminology to keep in mind when performing assessments is that there is a difference between a structure that has been classified as substantially damaged and one that has been classified as uninhabitable. Substantially damaged refers to a case where the dollar value of damage that has affected a structure is more than 50% of the value of that structure, whereas an uninhabitable designation generally refers to a legal or health-related issue that means the structure cannot be lived in. A given structure may be considered either substantially damaged, uninhabitable, or both. Generally, if the structure is substantially damaged, it is likely that it will also be considered uninhabitable. However, the reverse is not necessarily the case, as a structure that is considered uninhabitable may simply be in violation of a local code and may not be substantially damaged. Structures that have been classified as uninhabitable may be identified as such for a number of reasons, including health issues, a temporary lack of utilities, or building code violations. None of these cases would definitively mean that a structure was substantially damaged, but could very well occur simultaneously with a substantial damage determination. One of the keys to success and credibility of an SDE program is to ensure consistency in the way that substantial damage determinations are made. Every community is different, but officials who are performing damage assessments should communicate and coordinate frequently to make sure they are on the same page. It is also recommended that a community select a single method for determining building value and require all assessors to employ this same methodology across the community so that all structures are evaluated using the same criteria. It should also be noted that it is okay for determinations to be revised based on additional information that may be gathered at a later date, such as from a certified appraisal. Finally, it is recommended that all assessments be reviewed and quality controlled before they are finalized. Taking photographs while in the field can help facilitate this review process and avoid cases where assessments include inaccurate information. As you have learned in this module, the purpose of the SDE tool is to facilitate the process of carrying out substantial damage assessments to remain in compliance with the NFIP. The tool is flexible and can be used by inspectors of any level of experience to help organize all of the information that needs to be collected to make substantial damage determinations. In the modules that follow, you will learn more about how to effectively use the tool and perform assessments. Thanks for watching. This training is one of a 10-part series. Please continue to Module 2.